Ok.
Boa tarde a todas e a todos. Sejam todos bem-vindos ao nosso quarto dia de encontro do segundo GT Epiteto. E saudando de maneira especial também o nosso conferencista da tarde, Dr. Rafael Pereira. Está tendo algum retorno de microfone? Será que é o meu, João? Bom, o professor Rafael, ele é doutor em filosofia pela PUC do Rio de Janeiro, professor da UFG, faz parte da coordenação do GT Epiteto e orienta vários alunos no PPGF da UFG. Seja muito bem-vindo, professor. A palavra é sua.
Good afternoon. Thank you for Vilmar for the introduction. So I will do this presentation in English. I'm aware that I have a strong accent, so and that can be a little annoying, but and generate negative emotions. But remember that you're all trying to be stoic, so be patient with my accent. So I will speak about the problem of how to communicate truth. How can we make truth convincing? And this is an important point for Stoicism. So I speak about the tension between Stoicism and the rhetorics. About the point of how it's the correct way to communicate truth. And so what would be the difference between this and what the rhetorics do? And I think that's a very current problem for our nowadays, our world today. Because we live in the time of post-truth. So the actual context is a context where truth has lost a part of its value. We don't value truth anymore. So we have all these points about fake news and people. They think that there are no people think that there are no facts, just beliefs. So we can believe whatever we want. In internet, we always find a lot of people that think the same thing as us. So that's enough. To find narratives which satisfies us emotionally. So truth is not something important and we don't understand what it is anymore. And all this problem with fake news. And the point is that in this post-truth world, lies are more attractive than truth. One of the reasons why fake news has so strong impact is that fake news have more likes in Facebook, in Google, than truth. So fake news is more interesting. Lies are more interesting for people than truth. And so they circulate more, they have a more bigger influence on people, lies and fake news than truth. And truth is losing its place as an important reference. All the point about vaccine and all the fake news. So this problem is not exactly the same problem that the Stoics faced, but it's not so different after all. They also had this polemic with the rhetoricals, the rhetorics about how to make truth more interesting than just the speech that's not necessarily truth. It's just pleasant and emotionally interesting with ornaments and all that. So I will speak a lot a little about this tension between Stoicism and the rhetorics. This tension is especially important in the Roman Stoicism. There was at that time what's called the second sophistry. So rhetorics were very prestigiated people. They were professors they pay to teach lessons, and the techniques of rhetoric were very popular in Rome. So what would be the difference between rhetoric and Stoic speech? I will use a little of the analysis of Foucault in the Emanates of the Subject, in the lesson of the 10th March, I think, where he speaks between the difference between parhesia and rhetoric. He says that parhesia would be the speech, the philosophical speech, the speech with frank and honest and free. And parhesia has two adversaries: the rhetoric, and what he calls the flattery. Flattery, or in Latin, it's adulation, these adulators. And the point is that rhetoric usually is connected with flattery. It's a technique of flattery. So there is a lot of difference between this kind of speech and the philosophical speech. For instance, the ones who search the flattery, there are people who seek to be praised. They want to be applause. They want to be, so they speak in their own interest, because they have the orator. He has something to win with the speech. So they want to be praised, and we see soon some passage from Epictetus and Seneca talking about this, that the philosopher, the true philosopher, don't want to be praised. And the parhesia for Foucault, the philosophical speech, is directed to the interest of the other, of the audience. It's the one who is listening, who should be have some benefits from the speech. So that's an important difference. Also, the point of about emotions is very important, because the rhetorical speech is usually a speech, an emotional speech. So it seeks to manipulate people through their emotions. So with there are a lot of rhetorical ornaments in speech that seeks to have emotional effects. In the rhetoric of Aristotle, when he talks about rhetoric, that's exactly the moment when he makes one of the most important analyses of his work about emotions, for instance. So in this point about emotions, first, that it remembers us what happens today with fake news and all that, because why they have so great impact. It is, there are a lot of reasons, but one of them is that the fake news, they have a bigger emotional appeal. There are more interesting stories about the conspiracy stories and all that. They have a bigger emotional appeal. And for Stoicism, this point is very important, because we know that Stoicism, they relate emotions, the pathos, not all affective, but the pathos, the Stoics relate them to fake fake judgments about value. So there is some kind of connection between the pathos, the emotions, and fake news, if you want, with a speech that, so a speech which is not true, they tend to be a more emotional speech. And Galen, when he talks about the emotions, he sometimes talks about the point of the speech, I believe. And so this emotional speech is a way to manipulate people. So rhetoric, when it takes this form, is somehow a technique to manipulate people through their emotions. And for Stoicism, the philosophical speech must help people not to be manipulated, to be more autonomous, more virtuous, then more autonomous. So in a certain sense, not to have the emotions when they are related to fake fake flowered judgments about value. So which kind of speech can have this effect of not to be emotional appeal, but on the contrary, to help you not to be manipulated by the emotions? Which kind of speech would be this? So I have here, I took some passages from Epictetus and Seneca, and also from Diogenes Laerte, to talk about how about this tension about philosophy and the rhetorical. So I read a passage here in the Discourses of Epictetus in Book 3, the Discourses 23, so 3:23 in the Discourses of Epictetus. Let me find it here, just a minute. Yes, that's to those who read and discuss for the purpose of display, and you know, show off. And so that's the translation of Old Father I'm using. So Epictetus says that, let me see here, I took that. The rhetorician is not going to teach you how to live, how you ought to live. He's going to know full, but only when he ought to deliver a speech. For that's why he admires in you. So the point of the rhetoric is to have a beautiful speech, not to teach people how to live. And when you are in such a sorry state at this, then gap for men to praise you. So this relation between the rhetorical and the flattery, adulatio, the one who wants to be praised. Counting the number of your audience, it is your wish to do good to others. So this point that you do this speech for your own interest, not for the good of others. And so he quotes some rhetorical speaking. Oh, today I had a much larger audience. Oh, so he's ironic about that. Oh, yes, indeed, there are great numbers, 500, I fancy. No sense, make it 1,000. So what's important for the rhetoric is to have a great audience, to reach a lot of people. So there are a lot of people who are listening to me when I deliver my speech and all that. And it reminds me a little what's happening today. In internet, when the most important point is how many likes do you have? So, and the problem is exactly that fake news, they tend to be to have more likes. So it has more profit for the companies, Facebook and all that. If news has more likes, in fake news they tend to have more likes. So the rhetorics in the time of the Epictetus also they are very concerned with the size of their audience. So there are a lot of people who is listening to me. That's very important to them. So I continue to read this passage of the Discourses of Epictetus. Why should I listen to you? He says. Do you want to exhibit to me the clever way in which you put words together? So what's interesting in your speech? Is it the way you put the words together? You do compose them cleverly, man. And what good is it for you? But praise me. So the clever way you put the words together is a way to be praised. And what do you mean by praise, says Epictetus? Cry out to me, bravo, marvelous. All right, I'll say it. But if praise is some of these things which the philosopher put in the category of the good, what praise can I give you? So he starts to make this distinction between the praise, which the rhetorical looks for, and the good, what would be really good for people, for eudaimonia. So, you are concerned with anything that you with anything rather than what you should be concerned with, and that you are ignorant at the good and evil, and are wretched and miserable. So, The rhetorical speech doesn't help people to know, to have knowledge about the good and evil. It's just a matter of being praised. That, and yet, if the philosopher's discourse does not produce this effect, the effect of helping you to understand what good and evil is, if the philosopher's discourse does not produce this effect, it's lifeless, and so is the speaker himself. Rufus, he quote Rufus used to say, if you have nothing better to do than to praise me, then I'm speaking to no purpose. And if the only effect that my speech has is that I will be praised, then I don't know what I'm doing here. And then Epictetus says something fun and interesting. The lecture room of the philosopher is a hospital. You ought not to walk out of it in pleasure, but in pain. So the philosophical discourse should not be pleasant. On the contrary, it should produce more pain than pleasure. Because it must somehow convince you that your current beliefs are false. And not the pleasant belief is very different from a true belief. So the philosophical speech tries to show it, to teach it to people. And that's, again, a problem very similar for what we have today with fake news. That the problem of post-truth is precisely that people believe what they want to believe, what is pleasant. And truth is not important. And then he speaks, a point that I will speak about is that the philosophical discourse, speech, must have some kind of rhetoric. Because there are, if you want to speak the truth and you want somehow to convince people of it and help them to become virtuous and have a good life, so there is some ways of talking that are more adequate than others for this purpose. So the philosophical speech is not a speech with no concern of how you're speaking. So Epictetus in 323 talks a little about that. Isn't there such a thing as the right style for exhortation? Yes, who denies that? The ability to show to the individual as well as to the crowd the worrying inconsistency in which they are floundering about and how they are paying attention to anything rather than what they truly want. Okay, so I think that's all for this passage of Epictetus. Okay, so that's the discourses 323. Okay, now there is also some very good passage of Seneca about it. Just a minute, where the passage of Seneca? Okay, no, not this. Just a second. So there's many letters for Lucilius that talks about this rhetorical point. So in letter 29, for instance, Seneca says that the philosopher must adapt to his audience and wait for the right moment to talk. So as we talk later, kairos, the right moment, is an important point for philosophical discourse. And this idea that the philosophical discourse must be somehow more adapted to the profile of the audience. So it must establish some kind of conversation with them. In the letter 40, Seneca, he says that the best relation for philosophical speech is the relation between tête-à-tête, as we say in French, that between two individuals, the private conversation, between two people, which is very different from the popular orators who wants to talk, as we saw, to a very big audience. The bigger, the best for them. And so they want to talk with the collective. And philosophical speech is more directed to the individual. And with its particularities, adapting the discourse for the particularities of each individual. And in the letter 40, he also says that speech must be simple and transparent. And in letter 75, that's perhaps the most important letter about rhetoric in Seneca, he tells us again that we must communicate what we really think and we really feel. And let me take here the passage of Seneca. So the letter 75. He criticizes the artificiality of rhetoric speech with a lot of ornaments and artificial devices, and the great gestures and the great big tone of voice, very loud. And we don't need all that just to communicate what you think. No, he says in letter 75, our goal must be, I'm translating from Portuguese, so to state what you feel, how you feel, what you think. And another point is we must act accordingly from what you speak. So we must also, the philosophical speech is also an exemplary speech that we show the right thing to do, and we put set the example for the correct behavior. And he, Seneca, in letter 75, he also says something interesting about the idea that the philosophical speech must have some kind of rhetoric. There are more certain, how to speak is relevant also. So he says that in this discussion with the rhetorics, they use a lot, the Stoic authors, they use a lot the medical analogy. The philosophy is like a man for the soul. I have to heal the soul of the audience. So there's a medical analogy. And he says that someone who is ill doesn't want the doctor, is not interested in how right is the style, the rhetoric of the doctor. So it's not a point to speak well, the doctor. It's not what the ill person wants from the doctor. But if this man who is able to treat a disease, the doctor, is also able to explain it, how to do it, in a pleasant style, so he can, if he's able to explain what the ill person must do to in order to heal in a pleasant way and clear way, he should do that. Because in this sense, when the doctor speaks in a way which is pleasant and clear, he's also contributing to the goal of healing the patient. So the philosophical speech following this analogic medical analogy also must take care of how we speak. It's not a problem to speak in a pleasant way if this way to talk is integrated in the goal of speaking the truth and healing the soul of people. So the philosophical speech should not be completely unaware of how to. It's not irrelevant how to speak for the philosopher. Okay, so this was the letter 25 from Seneca. Okay, let me see what I have here. Okay. So in the sense. Okay. In the sense, when we talk this polemic between the Stoics and the rhetorics, it relates somehow to something that Socrates says in the Apology of Socrates, just in the beginning, when he says that I'm going to speak here naturally as the words come to my mouth, so with no techniques of how to say things, with no rhetorical or techniques. And I think that's where we came somehow between this tension between philosophy and rhetoric. We came relate it somehow to the distance between physis and nomos. So we should speak naturally. It's somehow related to the idea that we should live according to nature. And the artificiality of the rhetorical speech is somehow a kind of nomos, in the bad sense of the cynics, that is something that uncovers the truth. So that's an artificiality that takes us from way for living according to nature. So the philosophical speech must be somehow a kind of nature speak. But it is not. It doesn't mean, as I say, that it has no techniques or no idea of better ways to talk. And so Diogenes Laertius, in Book 7, when he talks about Chrysippus, he says that there are five virtues for philosophical speech. So speech must have five. There are five virtues for speech in order to communicate the truth, this philosophical speech. I have it here, just a moment. Yes, so that's the John Laes, Book 7, about Chrysippus. There are okay. So the five virtues of speech are, first, the correct grammar and good vocabulary. Clarity, two, clarity of expression, making the ideas easily understood. Free consciousness, employing no more words than necessary. So it might be not to use unnecessary words. Appropriations of style, suited to the subject, but also suited to the audience. And also some kind of artistic excellence, avoiding vulgarity. So that's in Diogenes Laertius. I use a little the resume of Don Roberts in the How to Think as a Roman Emperor did of it, but also took it from Diogenes Laertius. Okay, so the Stoics are also concerned of how to speak. So the point, the difference for rhetoric, not that not to care about how to speak. The point is that the rhetoric is usually related to flattery. So it uses the way of speaking is related to this kind of emotion manipulation for praise and all that. So here you can use again a little of Foucault. Foucault says that rhetoric has no necessary connection with truth, but it can be. So rhetoric is not something that is necessarily connected to lie, manipulation, or that. It's usually used for this purpose, but the techniques in itself could be used to communicate truth. So Foucault says that the parhesia must get free from rhetoric, but not to exclude it, but to use it. Not to serve the rules of rhetoric, but the parhesia must know how to use it in tactical defined ways when it is really necessary. So the philosopher, when he tries to speak the truth, he could use some rhetorical techniques when he thinks it's necessary in some specific context, in always as a way to communicate better the truth, and so to help the audience to know what's good and evil and all that. And so here I talk a little about some ideas of Martha Nussbaum in her book The Therapy of Desire, and some interesting things that she says about this Stoic rhetoric, somehow Stoic speech. So an important point that she makes in her book is that in Hellenistic schools, usually the philosopher has an ethical goal. So all these philosophical discussions, even metaphysical, or logical, or epistemic discussions, must always help us to get better people and to be virtuous and to have a good life. So the goal, the final goal is always an ethical one. There is a famous quotation from Epicurus when he says that there is no use for philosophy if it doesn't help people to get better lives. So that's the spirit of the Hellenistic schools. The goal must be ethical. So this practical goal, we could say this practical, makes very important for philosophy to convince people somehow, because the idea philosophy could not say, I said the truth. If the audience is not interested, if the audience doesn't want to know, that's the problem. I did my job because I said the truth. But if you think that philosophy has this practical goal to heal the soul of people and help them to have good lives and knowledge about good and evil, so the philosopher cannot be satisfied with that. He must try to convince people somehow in order to attain this practical goal. Again, there's a very important point for our context today with fake news, where we can't say that if people choose to believe in all those lies, that's their problem. No, it's not, because in the context of the new digital media, the internet, fake news, they have very, very strong and negative effects. So it cannot be indifferent to false beliefs. And that's the position that Stoics had. The false beliefs, they must be fighted. Okay. So Marta Nussbaum she discusses how should be philosophical speech in order to attain this practical goal, this ethical goal. She says that the Stoics use a lot of narratives. The idea is that, as we saw in the letter 75 of Seneca, the idea is to establish a almost personal connection with the audience. So for that, we must adapt for its particular context and the particulars of each individual in each audience. So establish a contact with them, like a private conversation. So the use of narratives, of stories, are very useful. And in fact, we see, for instance, in many of Seneca letters, those narratives, he tells stories about to illustrate the points of that he's making. And there is also an Epicurean in Roman world called Philodemus, who wrote a book called Periparesia. When he talks about how should be philosophical speech, and he makes this medical analogy, and also Philodemus thinks that Kairos is a very important point. So Kairos is precisely the taking consideration the circumstances where we are speaking, to who we are speaking, in which circumstances. So it's very important for philosophical speech to make this almost personal connection in order to attain this ethical goal of really modifying the beliefs of people. So there's a point that Marta Nussbaum makes, and also somehow the same line of thought, Philodemus. So to conclude, to conclude the idea is that so that philosophical speech must somehow make some important connections with people, almost an intimate connection. That's the point of Seneca when he writes letters to Lucilius to speak about philosophy. So it's like he has some kind of personal connection with the audience, with Lucilius. He talks about how your life and all that, and doing that, he's able to catch a bigger audience that other people that would be interested in reading the letters and also understand what he's saying. So to conclude now, yes. So we live in a world where truth is losing its value. Truth is not no more something important in our post-truth world. And it has a lot of negative consequences. So we must commit ourselves again with truth and convince people to commit themselves with truth. And for that, we must give truth some discursive force. It must sometimes be convincing also, to fight the way that fake news are convincing, like making emotional appeal, manipulation, and all that. So the philosophical discourse, or study, precisely discourse that helps you to see things objectively. But the point is that being objective, sometimes when you think about objectivity of science, we think that truth must be communicated in a cold and very descriptive way. And that's what helps fake news to be more interesting, pleasant for people. So we must seek truth can also, the point is that truth can also be communicated in an interesting way that attracts people, but without manipulating. And the way we talk is important in order to convince people of the truth. And so that's an interesting point, how this kind of narrative techniques and rhetoric techniques of the Stoics could be used in internet. How can I make this kind of personal connection in internet? Well, it's not impossible. That's an interesting point to discuss all this. So I think that's this debate, this tension that existed between the Stoics and the rhetorics about how to communicate truth could be useful for our current problems of the post-truth world. And said, that's all I had to say. So thank you for being patient in Stoics about my accent.
And very good presentation, Rafael. Very good. Congratulations. We haven't seen no question for a while.
I have around some questions. Thanks.
Me too.
Go first, Joelson, please.
Yes. You said at the beginning of your speech, fake news is more interesting than true. I agree. But is that because of the emotion? How kind of emotion can be aroused in the people? That when the people hear a fake news.
Yeah, it depends on the fake news, but usually, for instance, in fear, it's an important when we talk about the conspiracy theories about for instance about immigrants that tries to convince that immigrants are dangerous. So the idea of fear. That we should fear them, and also the feeling of hate, which was a very important feeling for the Stoics, the anger, the ire, and very often some fake news try to convince people to hate something, and also sometimes very pleasant, when you have when the reality is not very beautiful, it's ugly. So sometimes the fake news try to make it more beautiful. And then it appears for other emotions of pleasant and all that. So I think that you have here every negative or positive emotion, they all can be used to manipulate. We have a lot of
yes.
Perhaps the most useful one. Yeah.
Last one, you said to live in according to nature and the way to speak to people, it's very interesting. Please, could you explain it a little more?
Yeah, it's difficult. Yeah, I was using the famous statement of Socrates in the Apology when he says that I will speak here while the words comes naturally to my mouth. So I speak
freely,
without technique. I just speak what I think. So that's the correct way to speak the truth, and also as Seneca.
Okay.
Yeah. Naturally, yeah. As you think, you speak. Yeah.
Without techniques and recognizing.
Yes, in a freak way. Yeah. And as Seneca says in letter 75, it's very important that you communicate what you really think. That's the idea of parhesias. Yeah. And also that you act in the same way, that there's unity between what you say, what you think, and what you do. So this kind of unity.
And I think the effect in the soul, in the hegemonicon, is stronger when you speak this way. Agree. Yeah.
Truth can be strong. That's the point.
Yes.
We make truth strong.
Zeno, Epictetus speaking this way.
Yeah, exactly.
Directly. Yes. Correct.
That's orators. That are the Parhesians, in fact. Yes.
Okay. Thank you very much, Rafael. Aldo, please.
Thanks, Rafael. It's very interesting speech. First of all, if simplicity in telling people the truth is not pleasant at all, it's, as Epictetus put it, it's painful, how can we face fake news or pseudoscience also? As for instance, when you hear and you see some program about flying saucers, this kind of thing attracts us, right? But serious classes about philosophy and things like this do not attract us, do not give us pleasure, right? You said that we must establish a personal contact with the hearer, the listener. But how can we accomplish it? Do you have an idea?
Well, I think that to speak truth, you must somehow be more personal, as we're speaking to you particularly. I want to speak to you. What do you think? And that's what Socrates did and all that. And the point of that the scientific discourses is very often a very impersonal discourse, because we tend to associate objectivity with the science associates objectivity with being impersonal. And that's why very often the scientific discussion is not very interesting for people. And the Stoics teach us that the being objective can be related to being personal somehow. We can communicate truth by a personal discourse, like a private conversation. And that's the best way, because you say when we are going to tell people something that's not very pleasant, some bad news about, someone died and all that, you usually don't do that in a very personal way. You start to talk, how are you? So I have something to tell you. I understand that. So sometimes to say things that are not pleasant, you must establish first a personal contact and then say it. And then to prepare people to receive this bad news. And so perhaps the interesting lesson for Stoics is that telling the truth can be a matter of personal speech, not impersonal. A personal speech can help people to be more objective, to see things more objective.
Yeah, very interesting. I remember the Carl Sagan again. Carl Sagan did it. He talked to people in a personal way, right? As he was one of us.
Yeah, somehow in Cosmos, Carl Sagan did that, and he used a lot of narratives, a lot of stories, and that's exactly what Martha Nussbaum says about the Stoics, that this technique of speaking use narratives and stories, and as you say, Seneca doing with Lucilius, he tells stories, and exactly, I think that Carl Sagan did the same thing in Cosmos. He before talking about the ideas of Aristoteles, for instance, he first tells us the story of Aristoteles, so that we get more familiarized, more as we know him. This is a person, Aristotle. He lived that way. He was that way, and then he thinks that. Then it's like we are listening to the ideas. That's something that we know, a person, a particular person, and this would be the better idea to explain science, and that's exactly. I think that Carl Sagan did that something similar to the Stoics and to explain science. That's an interesting way. How can you do that in the internet world? Yes.
And also Xenophon's memorabilia is very convincing also, because it convinced Diogenes the dog to follow philosophy. It convinced also Zeno of Citium to follow philosophy. And maybe it is because of the way he talks things. He puts people in a dialogue, and yeah? A dialogue among friends.
Exactly. And that's convincing without manipulating. Yes, that's not convincing in the manipulating sense. That's convincing in the way that helping people to be more autonomous, and that's opposite of manipulation sentences. Yes.
Oh, Dinucci, your phone, your sound.
We have no questions in the on the chat. And how can we do it today? What's your proposal for this?
Yes,
the mission is to convince people to study philosophy instead of listening to fake news. How can you do this?
I think that internet is a very can be used for many different things. Internet is a very powerful device. That so I think that we could do this kind of personal engagement and this kind of speech in internet and try somehow to make it more important than fake news, because people don't like to be manipulated. They are manipulated, but at the bottom they don't like it. So if you show that a kind of speech that is not a manipulating speech, I think that it can be attractive to people, because people don't like, in fact, being manipulated. They don't realize that they're being manipulated. So that's the important thing. That's because I think that the problem with people who believe in fake news, that they think that that's good for them. Oh, that's what I think, so I'm free to think. I choose to believe what I want, and that's more pleasant. So it's important to show that's not good for them to have false beliefs. That's the Stoic idea. You're doing something. You're hurting yourself when you have wrong ideas. And so showing that fake news are bad for the people who believe in that would be interesting. And I think that internet has many ways, many kinds of sites and that kind of speech that can be supported by the internet. Okay.
Okay, you don't have any questions on the chat. I think you must put it on the paper so we can publish it. It's a very, I don't remember to read anything similar to it. It is very interesting and very helpful also. It sheds light on.
I should have used more slides, but the point that I want to speak, I wanted to speak like Socrates in the apology.
Okay.
I don't know if Socrates used some techniques. I don't know.
I think he used wine. Wine. He used a lot of wine.
Socrates today in the apology, he would have used some slides. Yes, here. That's why I shouldn't keep on that.
Okay.
What a pleasure.
Let's finish the.
Many thanks, Rafael.
Yes.
For giving me the opportunity to participate in this important event. Thank you very much.
Yeah. And you are in the core of it. You are one of the coordinators and founders of GT Epitetus.
Very proud of it.
Although I'm going to finish the transmission. Thank you, everyone.